here and praise the Lord. We're going to start that with hymn number 411. Hymn number 411, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Would you please rise?
Testimonies. might tell others of the good news of Jesus Christ. And we pray this in the name of our holy Savior. Amen. Thank you, baby. Seated. Let me say it's good to see all of you this morning. And I want to welcome everyone out from French Quarter. But it is a beautiful day outside.
I'm liking this new sound system. maybe the battery was a bad battery in this thing. But anyway, it's so good to see everyone, and I welcome everyone today. Thank y'all for coming out, and thank you for being here. It's absolutely gorgeous outside, and it's just absolutely beautiful in here because we are together in the name of Christ our Savior. We are together to just glorify Him. And we're so glad that y'all are here. To all of our home folk and to all of our visitors, it's good to see y'all back with us and with us maybe for the first time. And we're just so happy that y'all have chosen to be here with us today. Well, let me just go ahead and go through some of the announcements then. Some of them are in your bulletin, some of them are not. But let me remind you that we have our Sunday school classes, and we have classes for everyone. And we hope that you can come one Sunday for 10 o'clock and be a part of our classes. As we study the scripture together. Cornerstone will meet back tonight, 4 o'clock. This will be full Cornerstone for all of our students, and we have a full night planned for them. So we hope that you will be able to send your children or your grandchildren, or if you've got a next-door neighbor's kid that you want to get rid of for a couple hours, you can bring them too. That'll be all right, but we're going to have a great time with our kids tonight from 4 to 6 o'clock, and we sure hope to see your kids here with us tonight as we are together. Of course, our evening service is at 5 o'clock, and we'll have some singing, and we'll get into our Bible study. We're going back to Revelation tonight, so we hope that maybe you'll can be with us tonight for that. It'll be Revelation chapter 4 is where we're going to pick up at, and continue to study the Word of God as it was given to John on the Isle of Patmos. Of course, choir practice tonight at 6 o'clock. Anything you want to say about that, Joshua?
We've only had one practice, so come join us. We're still learning.
That's right. We've got a long way to go to Christmas, so yes, there's plenty of time for you to jump in and learn everything with us. Of course, beginning today, we are taking up for the Georgia Barnett, which is the state giving offering. Everything that we give for the month of October is 100% used by the Louisiana Baptist here within our state for the building of churches, mission programs, evangelism works, things like that, disaster relief. So our goal for the church this year is $400, and first four Sundays of the month, we'll be taking up for that. The theme for this year is nearby, looking at the person next door. I think there may have been a flyer in the bulletins this morning, a little bit more about that, so please take a look at it. And prayerfully, there they are. Prayerfully, think about what the Lord would have you give. Like I said, know that 100% of whatever you do give does go to ministry here in Louisiana. Of course, Wednesday nights we're beginning a new study on life and different life issues and life topics and how they relate to having Christ in our lives. And that's at 6 o'clock on Wednesday night. So we hope that you can be a part of that. 2 weeks from today, we will be observing the Lord's Supper. And for all of our visitors, just to make sure you know, we have an open policy about that. As long as you are a believer in Christ, you are more than welcome to partake in the Lord's Supper with us. And that will be in 2 weeks. And we hope that you are prayerfully ready to worship the Lord in that fashion. Fall Fest is coming up in 3 weeks, October 24th. We'll have a few more details each week as it comes up, but it will be 3 weeks from today, from 4 to 6:30, just to let you know on that. And our kids are helping to work on that, getting ready for it. Nursery volunteers. We still need a few more volunteers for the nursery. That way we have one person, all the Sundays taken care of in a month, or maybe even 2 months if we have enough. That sign up for it. So we still need a couple of volunteers to help out with the nursery. There is a sign up for it back there in the vestibule. And if you can do that, we would love to have you with this special ministry with the little ones as well. Let's see, the rabbit hole, Josh and I's little talk, Saturday nights at 5:30 on the Facebook page. We sure hope that you'll join us as we, last night we talked about sharing faith and telling others about Christ. This one's doing it too. Maybe it's just me. And then, of course, the Samaritan's Purse. We've got the shoe boxes coming up very soon, but this year we have been asked to be the drop-off center for the shoe boxes. And the week before Thanksgiving, we will be the collection site, and then from here they go to the next regional area. But we do have that coming up, and the missions committee needs some volunteers. We need different people just to come and sit to receive. It won't be an all-day thing, maybe an hour here or an hour there or 2 hours if you've got the time. We have a schedule that's up. For it, I believe it's on the Facebook page. It's on the Facebook page, but do we have any copies back here anywhere? Okay, there's a copy on the bulletin board. So if you're interested in the times, want to come in and start looking at it, right around here at the corner, we have a post up for it on the bulletin board with all the times, and we will need people just to help. It's just to receive, have someone here when people bring in the shoe boxes. And we stack them up so that they're ready to go out to the next place. But we are going to need help with that. The missions committee will appreciate anyone that can help be a part of that. But let me say again, it's so good to have everyone here. Thank y'all for coming. Thank you for being here. And let's just continue to sing this one. Josh and Ms. Praise the Lord.
All right, our next hymn is going to be hymn number 280. Hymn 280, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a cross.
children's church. You all's come. Now come on down. If I slowly come on down. Alright, so this morning, I'm kind of hobbled. Somehow I pulled a muscle or something in my leg. I don't know what I did. But you know what? It made me think about Paul. And we actually talked about him last Wednesday night. The Apostle Paul had a thorn in his side. And we don't know what it was. That's just what he called it, a thorn in his side. But it was something that hurt him, something that bothered him. We don't know what it was. But he prayed about it, and three different times he asked God to remove it from him. And this is what Jesus told him. He said, "My grace is sufficient." He said that my power is strongest when you're at your weakest. So sometimes when we're feeling bad or feeling sick, sometimes we need to remember that we're supposed to thank God for that too. Because when we're at our weakest, he's at his strongest. And he can really do great things for us because we're relying more on him in our lives. So let me say a prayer for you, and Miss May's going to take y'all next week. Lord, thank you again that we have the opportunity to have this special time of Bible study for our little ones. And I pray, Father, that they will just learn great things about you and your son. And I pray, Father, that they will learn about trust and how you are sufficient, that you are everything that we need. And God, that they will just learn how to just give their lives to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
When they got into the boat, the wind ceased,
Then those who were in the boat came and worshiped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." Let's pray. Lord, what an incredible story. What an incredible feat, a miraculous feat of your power. What an incredible display of your mercy. Lord, there are so many ways that this sermon could be, this message, or this text, excuse me, could be preached. There's so many different messages that we can pull out of this. But Father, the way that you have instructed me today, I pray, Father, I know that the Holy Spirit has gone before to prepare the hearts for the reception of this message. And I pray, Father, that when we leave here, we will glorify you. We will say, "Truly, you are the Son of God." That is the greatest testimony that any of us could share. So, Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit will speak. We are listening. We pray, Lord, that you will change our lives today. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This is one of my most favorite parts of the scripture, one of my most favorite accounts of the Lord Jesus. Now, we must say that this one is different from the scripture that Shelby read for us just a while ago, because in it he commanded the sea to be still. But in it, it said that when he got in the boat, it's calmed down. And the disciples were so amazed, and they said, "Truly, you are the Son of God." But I want us to think for a minute about what happened just before this. They had just fed the 5,000. And that's what's happening. And when it says in verse 22, that immediately Jesus made his disciples go before him, Jesus was going to clean up. Jesus was going to make the disciples, or all the multitude, send them on home. It was getting late. The disciples were to get in the boat, go across, and Jesus says, "I'll meet you on the other side." And it's funny to me that none of them questioned him about how he was going to get there. You know, was he going to walk around the Sea of Galilee? Was he going to get on another boat and row himself across? They never even questioned that. Well, how are you going to do that? The Sea of Galilee is quite large. So he sends them on their way, and he finishes up, and he tells everyone, you know, "Bless you and thank you for being here," and he sends them on their way back home. But notice what he does. Instead of going right straightway to be with them, he went up to the mountain. He went up on the mountain to pray. Now Jesus made the people go home, Jesus made the disciples go. He said, "I want you to go," and he commanded them to, and they went on their way across the Sea of Galilee. They were on the sea because that's where Jesus wanted them. I want you to think about this story in a context that you've never thought of before. The disciples were in the boat in the middle of the Sea of Galilee because that's where Jesus wanted. He told them to go. They faced the storm in the middle of the Sea of Galilee because that's where Jesus wanted them. Nothing that happened in the lives of the disciples when they were following Jesus, nothing that Jesus told them to do and something arose, when nothing was haphazard, nothing was just by chance. Jesus was in charge of all things. Jesus knew all things. So when Jesus says, "Go over there," he had the storm planned. He had everything planned out. So when you think about this, again, consider that. The disciples were exactly where Jesus wanted them to be. They didn't just happen to be there. Jesus didn't just happen to walk up on them in the middle of the sea. It was all done by design. It was all done by plan. It was all done a beautiful night. And it could be so that that's why they were out there for so long. But then the wind started coming. And actually the Bible just said that they had trouble rowing. So the storm started to pick up a little bit at a time, and they started to row and try to make it to the other side. But I truly believe that maybe they stopped for a little bit just to enjoy it. So they're out there roughly about 6 hours. It's the fourth watch. It's somewhere between 3 and 6 a.m. And all the time that they were out there in the sea, I want you to think about this. Jesus was preparing for this moment. He was preparing the disciples to receive him to walk on the water. He was preparing the disciples to have a special lesson, a special thing planned for them. He was preparing on going out there to demonstrate who he truly was. All this is planned, okay?
This is the most important thing to get the message, to get the points that I want to share with you today. You've got to get that first. All of this is planned. So let's see what happens. Number one, Jesus wanted to make them into something completely new. He wanted his disciples to become something completely new. And he had to put them in a setting where something had never happened before that could let them see Jesus in a new light and see their position and their ministry with Jesus in a new light. Again, I said, Peter and Andrew and James and John, they knew about being on the sea because these guys were real fishermen. Of all the 12, these four were the fishermen. So being out on the water, I'll bet all the other eight were like, okay, you guys get us there because you're the water guys. And these four guys were the fishermen. They were real fishermen. But there was one problem that the four of them had. Actually, there was one problem that all 12 of them had. And that problem is that they were not yet the kind of fishermen Jesus wanted them to be. They were still just fishermen. They were not fishers of men quite yet. Because the problem is they didn't have the right attitude. Oh, they were excited about following Jesus. Oh, they were excited about being with the Messiah. But you've got to remember the Jewish mindset of the day. Messiah was supposed to be someone who was going to conquer Rome. Messiah was going to be someone who was going to make Israel the most powerful nation in the world. He was coming to be the king over all the earth. And that's what they're expecting. That they're waiting and they're basically salivating at the fact that this is what Jesus is going to do. He's going to make his move and soon we're going to be on top. I mean, in fact, you know, James and John's mother even asked Jesus, so when you're on your throne, which one of my brothers will be at your left and your right side? Because that's what they were expecting of Jesus. So they didn't have the right attitude yet. They didn't have the attitude necessary. They were missing the most important ingredient, and that's faith. Jesus wanted to make them something completely new because they needed to have a faith that they have not yet had. The Sea of Galilee incident was created by Jesus so that he might give them the kind of faith that they needed. Jesus' intention to feed the 5,000 was to stretch their faith. Now, remember, they had just done this, and they've got the leftovers with them. But when they get to the other side, anybody remember how many they fed on the other side? 4,000. So what Jesus did with the loaves and the fish was to stretch their faith. It was to stretch their minds to see something bigger and greater. And this is the bigger lesson, that they grow in faith. So this is the first part of what's going on here. Now the second thing that Jesus wanted to do was that he wanted to shock them with something completely new. Can you imagine being out on the boat and all of a sudden somebody comes walking up to you? I mean, that would be shocking. In fact, they said, it's a ghost! Because no mortal can do this. This must be some kind of spirit. This must be some kind of evil spirit. But it was Jesus. Because he wanted to shock. This was part of the plan. Jesus walking on the water was part of it. This was Jesus' specific goal. To shock them. To shake them up. To unnerve them. To show them something that they have never seen before. Because let's go back, okay? Let's flash back a couple of weeks. For the last few weeks, they've watched him perform great miracles. They've seen him raise a little girl from the dead. They just witnessed him feeding the 5,000 there at the masses, for 5,000 men plus the women and the children. They saw all these great things. And to us, when we read these stories, these are great miracles. We can't believe that this kind of stuff happened, that Jesus could do that. But let's go back to the mindset of the day. Let's think about these 12 guys, the 12 disciples. They were Jewish. They were teaching tools that their parents had passed on to them. What Jesus did was nothing more than some of the prophets of the Old Testament. Let's take Elijah, for example. Remember when Elijah went to the widow's home in Zarephath? And he went in there and he asked for food. And she said, this is all that I have left. I just have this little bit of oil and this little jar of flour, of meal. This is all that I have left. I don't know if I can spare it. And he said, please, make me a cake. And the woman is so hospitable. And the woman sees this man of God and she does this for him. And she bakes Elijah a cake. And what does Elijah do? He prays, and through the power of God, the woman never goes hungry again, because all of a sudden she has all the meal, all the oil, all the food that she could imagine. Now that sounds like the feeding of the 5,000, but that wasn't the Son of God. That was Elijah that did it through prayer. And let's remember, a few weeks later, that same widow, her son died. And it was just her and her son. And he was everything to her. And she got word to Elijah that this terrible thing had happened. And what did Elijah do? Elijah went back. Elijah prayed heavily over this boy's corpse and raised him back from the dead through the power of God. And what did Jesus do? He raised people from the dead just like Elijah. So in their minds, the disciples could very well have been thinking, well, this was something the prophets of old could do. He is a prophet of God today. Surely he can do the same thing. So Jesus did something a little different. Jesus did something that no prophet in the Old Testament had ever done. Jesus did something that only God could do. Jesus did something to reveal himself. He walked on the water and he shocked them. They weren't shocked when he raised the dead. They weren't shocked when he fed the 5,000. They weren't shocked with all the healings. They were in awe, and they couldn't understand how he did it. But the Bible says the word that's used here, this is the first time it's used, they're shocked. They're afraid, because this is something that has never happened before. This is something that no mortal, like I said a while ago, can do. It's a ghost. It was the Son of God enacting his power as God. And he shocked him. This is part of the plan. Next thing, Jesus wanted to educate them to be something completely new. He wanted to make them something new. He wanted to shock them with something new. And now we find out that he wanted to educate them to something completely new. Up till now, Jesus had been gradually intensifying the level of the disciples' education. He started off very simple and very quiet with the wine, the water into wine, and then he turned up the volume here and there. He turned up the volume with each lesson. He turned up the volume with each miracle. If you were to go through the miracles of Jesus in order, you'll see how each one is a little bit more, and a little bit more, and a little bit more. And he's building up the disciples with each one until they got here, and he is building them up one experience at a time, and only after experiencing everything else that they already had were they ready for this challenge. Jesus did not send them into the water until they were ready. Jesus did not walk on water to them until they were ready. Jesus did not allow this incident to happen until he knew the disciples were at the right level that they could work. See, everything that happens in our lives is God teaching us. Everything that happens in our lives is God raising us to a new level of faith. Everything that happens in our lives is God making us better and better and more like Christ and more like him, so that we can be a better influence. Everything that happens in our lives is spiritual growth. And here's where the disciples were. It was now time to shock them. It was now time to give them this great lesson. Listen to this. After he built relationship with them, he allowed them to see his power in a non-threatening way. He was ready to reveal a power to them that nobody else had ever revealed before. He was ready to show them something that they had never seen before, something like nothing that has ever come before. He displayed his power as God. And what was the end result? Truly, you are the Son of God. They declared it. Because they saw, this is the first time the group group says this. Now they are beginning to see Jesus for who he really is. Now they're starting to understand who Jesus is. So it's a lesson. Jesus, and remember, he's up on the mountain praying. And everything Jesus did, he prayed before he did it. He prayed before the crucifixion in the Garden of Gethsemane. He brought Lazarus back from the dead. He prayed over everything to make sure God received the glory for it. And I truly believe that as he was up on the mountain praying, as they're out there in the water for 6 hours, that he was praying for their hearts to be ready to receive the lesson that he wanted to teach. Which brings me to the fourth thing that I really wanted to say this morning, and this is it. You cannot grow in your faith sitting in your seat and waiting. What happened? Peter said, "Lord, if you will, let me come to you. Let me walk on the water to you." And Jesus said, "Well, come on." And Peter hopped out of the boat, and think about it, as soon as he came over the side of the boat and his feet hit the water, he was standing right in the middle of the Sea of Galilee as if he were standing on the ground. And there was no other person in that boat that asked that question. There was no other person in that boat that said, "I want to come out there to you, Jesus." There was no one else willing to take, no pun intended, a leap of faith. But Peter did. Now I want you to think about something for just a minute. How about Peter? Peter was a hothead. Peter usually shot off at the mouth. Peter was very outspoken. He had a very short views. So for Peter to give this response was actually uncharacteristic of Peter. But I truly believe that God caused Peter to say this. And that this was an answer to Jesus' prayer. I believe that while Jesus was praying all night long, remember that, that Peter's response fits right into what Jesus wanted to teach them. Faith. Faith and trust. This is how God works. He gently draws us into deeper and deeper walks of faith. And he brings us closer and closer to him in these steps, in these phases. Everything that happened on the Sea of Galilee was done for a reason. Now I say again, Peter actually tried. He jumped out of the boat and he exercised faith in God, but he got caught up with what was going on around him. He lost track of Jesus. But you know what that reminds me, makes me think of? That sooner or later, we've all got to jump out of the boat or get up off of our pew. Sooner or later, we have to exercise the faith and say, "Lord, send me. Lord, put me where I need to go." Jesus is standing on the water of the storms of your life, whatever storms are going on. And he's standing right there ready to say, "Come." He's standing right there ready to tell you to get off that pew. He's standing right there ready for you to say, "Lord, I'm growing. And I believe that you can do this in my life. I believe that you can use me in this way." Remember what James said in James chapter 2, verse 20? He said that faith without works is dead. If we're believers in Christ, we need to show it. We need to be doing the work. If we're believers in Christ, we need others to see the depth. 11 stayed in the boat, and one said, "I believe." And he jumped out of the boat. This is what Jesus is doing. Jesus is trying to do something in your life that's never happened before. He's trying to show you something completely new. He's trying to make you into something completely new. He's trying to teach you something completely new. Because Jesus is ready for you to jump out of the boat. To jump out of the pew. To jump out of your comfort. So that he might do a great work for you and through you. Let's all pray together. Father, I thank you so much. Again, Lord, I can't state enough that this was planned. That this had a purpose. And Father, of the 12, only Peter responded to that purpose. He's the only one that responded to the lesson to be taught. But Father, they all believed. They all grew in their faith. And Lord, I pray that as we hear your word declared, as we read your word, as we pray, as we hear testimony, as we go to worship or
or watch other worship services that we might see on TV that are truly centered in Christ. Pray, Father, that we grow. I pray that we hear the lesson, that we learn the lesson, that we become something new as you are revealing something new to us each and every day of our lives. Lord God, I pray that today would be the day that someone has something new and fresh as they walk out of these doors. I pray, Father, that we are all challenged, that we are all changed, that we will all have a new perspective of you and a new perspective of your love for us. I pray, Father, that today, more than any other day, we will have the courage to step out of the boat. Now, with every head bowed, every eye closed, Miss Maureen's going to begin to play our hymn of invitation. Where are you today? Are you just sitting in the boat watching? Are you standing in the boat thinking about stepping out? Are you ready to take the jump? How is Jesus revealing himself to you? How is Jesus showing you something that you've never seen before? How is Jesus trying to make you new? Will you come to him today? The altar is open. I'm here. Will you come to Jesus and say, Lord, let me walk on the water today for you? Thank you, Ms. Norrie. Thank y'all so much for being here today, for being in the service and part of the service. Thank you for coming to worship today. I pray that something that we did this morning, something truly touched you, and you'll leave here refreshed and renewed, and that you will say it has been good to be in the house of the Lord. Remember tonight, Cornerstone begins at 4, and then at 5 o'clock, our evening service in here. Then we're going to go into Revelation chapter 4, and we invite y'all to come and be a part of that tonight. Choir practice at 6, Wednesday night, Bible study, and everything else that's coming up. Thank y'all so much for giving the time. It's so good to have y'all. Love y'all and appreciate y'all very, very much. All right. Well, let's stand and dismiss our service today. And as we do, I'm going to ask Brother Terry, if you wouldn't mind, sir, to voice our